unboxing another Blu-ray haul. Every year in the spring, Shout Factory has a sale on their out-of-print or going-out-of-print-soon titles. And it's your last chance to buy them. And usually they're the best time to buy them in some ways because they're like the absolute lowest prices you can get them for. But at the same time, you risk not being able to get a copy of something you want. But usually the things that end up in the out-of-print sale are lesser-known movies, things that maybe didn't sell as well, things that maybe Shout Factory lost the rights to do another run of, and they're more obscure movies a lot of the time. Like things from the 60s and 70s that are a bit weirder, which is my favorite thing, so it's good for me, but not every release is gonna be Halloween or Friday the 13th, so. Because I didn't know what it was when it came in the mail. It's been a little bit of a while since I placed my order, and that's to be expected. Shout Factory still has the disclaimers about COVID and backlogs and things on their site, so you don't expect to get your stuff right away, which is fine. I'm fine supporting these companies and getting something later on down the line. It's the same with Waxworks. You have to wait a long time sometimes for your shipment to get there, especially if you're a subscriber. Or Vinegar Syndrome. Sometimes you have to wait a couple months or whatever. And unfortunately, Amazon has made it, so most people expect their stuff right away. And the people who don't understand what it's like running a smaller mid-grade or even an indie business has no idea, which is unfortunate. So, but it didn't have any of the normal branding on it, which is weird. Usually Shout Factory has branding on the box or the paper. Inside has the logo all over it, and it didn't say Shout Factory anywhere on the label, so I was very confused about what had to come. Sometimes I'll get random gifts in the mail from friends or family, and they don't tell you that it's coming, because that's happened occasionally where I'll just get something and I'm like, I don't have any idea what this is or where it's from. And it's a mystery, and I didn't know what this was because of the labeling. But opened it up and yep, it was the Shout Factory's. last year. I got a bunch of the B-1960s sci-fi movies, which is really cool. So this year I think these are all 70s movies, which is great. Let's see. What should we start with? We'll start with Dr. Blood's Coffin. We dare you to look into Dr. Blood's Coffin. Can you stand the terror, the awful secret it contains in goriest Eastman color? This one's actually a 60s one, so they're not all 70s. But this is one of those weird, icky 60s ones that wasn't quite as mainstream, was in the drive-in, and they got away with a little bit more of gore and things, so. This was the only one I didn't know as much about from the order, but the covers caught my eye many times throughout the last few years when I've been looking at Shout Factory stuff. And I don't really shop Shout Factory very much anymore. I generally try to give my money mostly to Vinegar Syndrome because they're my favorite. They do the most weird and obscure films. They do the best job of restoring it. I'll occasionally get something from Severin as well because they do really amazing box sets, like the Andy Milligan set, which is my favorite thing I own in my DVD collection. So, a monster traded from the depths. The same artwork as the cover, but you get the actual poster on the inside. It's really cool. This is rated X. That would make sense for the 1960s. Because if it's got gore in it, like at all during that time period, it gets an X rating. And back then, X rating was the equivalent of NC-17 today, so. So it could potentially be pretty horrific for a 60s film. And sometimes during that era, movies would just slap X or triple X or whatever on it to get more people into theater. So, next we have Full Moon High, which I've looked at buying many, many times, mostly because I love, love, love Teen Wolf so much. And another high school werewolf movie. It's a comedy. Obviously, this is going to be different than Teen Wolf. Teen Wolf was like a very mainstream release with Michael J. Fox, who was a pretty big name at the time and upcoming in films. He was known on TV and things. But this is a little bit more of something else. So this one's been made in 81, so it just missed that 70s mark because I they all fall in that area. So, yeah. This is from Larry Cohen, actually, and I'm not used to comedy films from him. He is the director of It's Alive, which is the killer baby movie, which was surprisingly good, and creepy, a little bit slow, but, and Cue the Winged Serpent, of course, but yeah. So yeah, it'll be really interesting to see. He's today's teenage werewolf. Only the rules have changed. Thing with the cartoon artwork on the disc, and then a still from the movie in there. It's gonna be goofy. So that's Full Moon High. Okay, two more. The next two actually were a drive-in double feature that came out together. And I've been interested in both of them for a long time. One more than the other. We'll do the one that I was most interested in out of the whole stack of movies last. But they're a double feature, so. Super Beast. And I believe this is the Super Beast that inspired the Rob Zombie song. So. A little gross, grotesque. Little 70s movie. Rated R, of course. And it's one of those, like, tropical island themed type of horror movies from the 70s. And I always really like those. Adds to the idea of the isolation, a place that a lot of people idolize as being tropical, is actually really dangerous. And I think that's actually kind of true sometimes. People, I mean, we have always these stories of tourists going to these really nice vacation spots and then doing something really stupid and getting themselves hurt by the wildlife or, you know, falling into some pit or, you know. So, but I just really enjoy them. They're very creepy. And not sure what that's about. I went to Hawaii when I was 16 with my grandparents. And I remember just feeling very freaked out being there in the first place, being a boy from the middle of America, you know, the West Midwest area. Not near ocean ever, hardly at all. Very little humidity out there. And then you go out to this island and you see this kind of stuff in movies all the time. But you get there and it's gorgeous, but it's also like intimidating because it's so new and different. And even the sky just looks so different out there in some ways. And I felt kind of like out a little bit by realizing that we were completely surrounded by water and in this totally different location I'd never been in before. And it was the first time I'd really traveled, it was the first time I'd been on a plane, all those things. So that all contributed to it. And I've heard stories from friends or acquaintances who, you know, grew up in London or in Japan in the Philippines and things, and they come to the middle of America, and it's equally as weird for them. because they're used to their locations, you know, so. But maybe that contributes to why these locations are extra interesting for me to watch, so. See a half man, half monster ripping helpless victims to shreds in his mad hunger for human flesh, and it's a really great cover. Kind of like, Island of Dr. Moreau, almost. So, let's see if I can get this open. Sorry, enough of my rambling. Again on the disc, and then another steal from the movie here, and you see these two doctors examining this John Doe body. Honestly, like, it's cool they have the images on the inside. I really like that, but in general, like, Shout Factory and Scream Factory kind of tend to be bare bones with their releases, so it's fun. I enjoy unboxing them with you guys and showing them off and talking about the movies and hopefully reviewing them down the line. Hard time actually reviewing the movies because I should watch them late at night and I'm tired afterwards and I go to sleep and then I don't review it. Then I have to rewatch it later if I want to review it, so. But compared to, like, Vinegar Syndrome, their releases just don't have a lot to them. Which is fine. They're kind of, in some ways, a budget company when it comes to this kind of stuff. But that's why it's really hard when they decide to charge a lot for one of their Blu-rays, because it's like, what's on this that's gonna make it worth it? I can spend less on a Vinegar Syndrome one and have it be something I really love. So, here's the one I was most interested in and excited about. I really love 70s vampire and Satan films and cult films and all those things. And so, Daughters of Satan is right up that alley and one I've been wanting to watch for a long time, and I'm very excited to have it. This is a wonderful front cover, very evocative, very scary looking, and makes you want to watch it, so. And it's got Selleck in it, guys. There he is. Tom Selleck. He did so many weird movies. Be careful what you wish for with this spellbinding thriller. Disc art as usual, a rendition of the art from inside, and then another steel shot with Tom Selleck. Wonder if these both were filmed in the Philippines and that's why they were on a double feature. Who knows? I don't know. So it should be interesting. Anyways, that's it. That is the Shout Factory out of print sale for the spring of this year. Thanks for watching, and make sure to like and subscribe if you like these videos. I've kind of slowed down on putting out videos, mostly because it's a lot of work. It's my hobby. It's not my full-time job, so if you like unsubscribe, I am more inclined to do them